So, Mischa, EarthShip.
This building's a very, very different building to what most buildings are. Most conventional buildings are plugged into a series of very, very large scale grids of infrastructure. So they will be plugged into one for water, for electricity, probably for gas, and there'd be one for sewage to take away all of that as well. This building's very different. What we have here is a building that reaches out with its arms and kind of gathers everything that it needs from the immediate world around it, which sounds a bit hippie-ish and a little bit strange, but really it's a very sensible approach to a building and how it collects the resources that it needs to make it very, very habitable. So what we have is a building that's designed to harness all of the sunlight that falls onto it, whether that be for electricity or for space heating or for water heating. And it's designed to harness the wind that blows past the site and makes the wind turbine spin round. And it's designed to harvest all the rain that falls on the roof. And this is the crucial difference. The crucial difference between this style of building and most other styles of building is that all buildings have interaction with weather, but most buildings, other than getting a little bit eroded by the process, don't take anything away from it. This is a building that's fully designed to harness and to work with the natural systems and to take from those renewable, free-flowing, abundant natural systems and harness them for all of its building services, for heating, for water heating, for lighting, whatever you need really. So it's a building that looks after you and has a very, very low environmental impact.
How long have you been working on it?
5 years, probably 4 years I would say, building wise, but yeah. So it's quite fortuitous really, because this week, in fact yesterday, was pretty much the end of the project. So it's quite strange that it's been kind of four and a half years of solid work, suddenly it's come to an end. So it's sort of nice really, sort of end of a phase and beginning of another phase.
And what's the phase that's beginning?
Well, the main thing with this project was to build a building that had a very, very low carbon footprint in the way that it was built, but particularly in the way that it runs, so it doesn't use much energy in its day-to-day running. That's the idea, really, and demonstrating lots and lots of principles that enable that. And now we've built the project, we can focus more on telling people about the ideas and breaking it down and giving tours to school kids and college, university, students and other folks really. So just lots and lots of people coming down to see what we've done and why we've done it.
The way that EarthShip has been made, could that be done on a large scale, do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what I'm really interested in more than the EarthShip itself is the concepts that make it up. There are a variety of different things that it's doing. Such as it's built from low impact materials, it harvests sunlight for space heating, it's passive solar in other words. It uses renewable energy for all of its kind of lighting and other requirements, electrical requirements, and harvests all of its water from the skies, and lastly it treats all of its sewage on site with plants. So that's really what we're interested in, and particularly what I'm interested in. So it's taking those different concepts and dismantling them really and out of the EarthShip concepts and putting them into other more regular forms of building, I think is the real challenge. And I think in that guise, I think the opportunity to deploy the EarthShip concept is limited. But I think if you tweak it slightly, I think there's a huge, huge opportunity to implement all of those different areas into new builds. And some of them can be retrospectively fitted into old houses as well. So maybe they're not up to the level of what we're doing here, but they're a big, big improvement on what they're doing at the moment, really. So, and that, in a sense, in this country, is probably the most crucial piece of work. And it was one of the reasons why we chose the EarthShip as an idea. We were looking for a very progressive form of building to demonstrate all of the concepts of low carbon living that we wanted, and we stumbled across the EarthShip, which is a style of building that a gentleman called Mike Reynolds invented and pioneered out in America, out in the high sort of desert mesa and plains of New Mexico. And out in the desert, you don't have any infrastructure. If you want to drink water, you have to harvest it. If you want electricity, you have to collect it, and so on and so forth. And so the whole concept of the EarthShip in the desert is that there's no infrastructure, there's nothing in place. And the most interesting thing about the EarthShip is really taking those lessons of efficiency and small scale systems and putting them into existing buildings and making them more useful and more efficient.
Sounds great. Government support, how's that working out?
Government support.
Yeah.
Like many things, government support is unfortunately thin on the ground. There's a lot of good rhetoric, a lot of positive statements being made, but when you dig below the surface a little bit, there's not so much happening as could be, really. But really, we should be thinking in leaps and bounds. As an example, the level of insulation you'd find in a Swedish building is almost, in terms of the amount of insulation, almost exceeds what we have in buildings today built to our 2006 regulations. So we can see that we're very, very much behind the game in terms of what we need to be doing. And building regulations are an amazing tool because everyone has to abide by them. The other side of that is the fact that nobody particularly gets prosecuted for flouting for building regulations of certain types and energy performance and such. So perhaps that's another issue. So yes, government in terms of rhetoric is very, very forward. In terms of practical action, it's very lacking, unfortunately, in this day and age. And it's 2007 now, almost 2008, so we're almost a decade through the first 10 years of the millennium, so the new millennium. So yeah, we haven't seen too much movement forward, really.
What about in public consciousness? Over the time that you've worked on this project, have you noticed much difference? Much increased awareness?
Yes, there's been a huge, huge explosion of awareness in the last few years. I mean, when we started this project, seems like a lifetime ago, but it was about 4 or 5 years ago, we seemed very much on the fringe of activity. And I guess to a certain extent, we probably still are, but I think the whole idea and concept of people actually caring about the planet that we live on, and there has been a huge, huge mushrooming of public consciousness in the last sort of year, 18 months, which is fantastic. The trick now is to take that starting, that groundswell, that movement, all of that consciousness, and to translate it into effective, practical action. That's the crucial point. Being aware of something is the first point. Once you're aware of it, you can act on it. And that's the point that we're now starting to get to. How can we act efficiently? That's the key. Efficiency is the key. Well, the government has offered stamp duty on zero carbon houses, zero stamp duty on zero carbon houses. It's an empty gesture because there aren't many zero carbon houses. In fact, I'd be amazed if the government loses a penny over that particular piece of legislation. Really regulating more rigorously highly carbon polluting companies and their activities. There are lots and lots of things government could be doing. Government can lead and government should lead. And one of the most interesting things that we have now, the point that we're at, is everybody says that the market leads. Well, we know where the market leads us. The market has led us to the point that we're at. The government has a democratic mandate. The market doesn't.